Well, good morning, everyone. And thank you for the invitation, Pastor, to be here. This is my coming out service. I've not stood in front of a congregation since before lockdown. I do most of my ministry online these days. You would have been given a card about Life Radio UK. That's a ministry I started up soon after I was let go from the conference a couple years ago. And I've been doing radio for over 30 years, and I thought, Lord, I'm not going to be going out looking for commercial work. I'll give my time to that kind of ministry, and the Lord has been blessing us thus far. So if you get a chance to listen in, please do so. And also, if you are interested, anyone of you studying media or would like to get into media ministry, then give me a call, because there's opportunities for you to be part of this as well. You do it all from your home. That's the beauty of it. You don't need to leave your house to go to a studio. A microphone and good connection, that's all you need. Very simple. So have a chat to me later on. My wife is here with me, Sonia. And, you know, it seems I have been here before, because I recorded some Sabbath school lessons at the back. But it just looked totally different. Because I've been to the previous one as well, so that's why. But it's good to be with you. And I'm not a preacher. I like to just share the word, and I don't mind you talking to me either. And I also like to give way to you, first of all, because part of worship is expressing your gratitude to God. So my brother there, who said he's not got a job, and that's giving thanks to God. I don't know if anyone else wants to give thanks to God at this time for anything that he has done for them. You see, because coming here, part of it is that, expressing what God has done for you. I've done nothing for you. I didn't bring the sun out this week, did I? I didn't put food on your table. So give God the opportunity to be thanked. So if anyone wants to give a word right now, I'll stand aside and just wait for you first of all. Is there anyone at all?
Yeah, on Zoom again.
Yeah, gotta get used to that. Yeah. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, I've got arthritis, and this time last year I was walking very uncomfortably, if much at all. And now with working with a lifestyle doctor and with medication, I'm doing much better. I can walk like 4 kilometres, which is, you know, much more than I was doing before.
Amen.
I can Amen. Do a lot more. I feel a lot more comfortable, so I'm very thankful.
Amen. Amen. Anyone else want to, online or in the room? What has God been doing in your life? My sister.
I want to thank the Lord that my probation hasn't closed yet.
There you go. There you go. You know, when you are concerned about being with the Lord, these are important issues. I can't give you a date, but the fact that you are concerned that, you know, am I right in my relationship with God is a sign that the Spirit of God is still moving in your life. Anyone else?
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Amen. And from all the medical programs I've been watching, you're going to need it. Because all those names and and working under such pressure and long hours. Yeah, yes. Anyone else? Go ahead, my brother.
It's been an interesting observation throughout the pandemic. I know, and I say this very, very carefully, I'm well aware of how many people have been struggling because of the effects of. And I'm just really grateful for the fact that we as a family, mm-hmm. we've not struggled, and consequently we have been provided with more opportunities than we could have ever known to maybe sort of give a hand to people who need it.
Well,
so I'm sort of quite humbly grateful for that.
Absolutely. Absolutely, absolutely. It's caused havoc in many people's lives, the pandemic, but it's brought many blessings as well. many people have found new ways of serving the Lord. Many people have found ways of spending time with their families. Some not so much, you know, because when the early days you're locked up so long. But they found new ways of just enjoying the day or thinking differently about life. So, yeah. Anybody else? Pastor.
I think this is probably my favorite time of year. Mm-hmm. With the blossom on the tree.
Yes. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Bit tricky for me, though, in this country because of the hay fever. Funny enough, things that I suffer with here, if I go to Jamaica or America, I don't suffer with them. Is the Lord trying to tell me something? Don't know. Anyone else? All right, let me share a word with you this morning. Luke chapter 22, we read it in our scripture reading. Verse 31 and 32. The Lord said, "Simon, Simon, indeed Satan has asked for you." That's worth holding on for, holding on to. Satan has had to get permission to trouble us. And God gives that permission because he knows he can count on us. He has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for you. I've read this so many times before, but only recently that phrase has been jumping out at me. But I have prayed for you. Jesus is praying for me. Sometimes I feel my prayers don't move above the ceiling, but Jesus is praying for me that you should not, your faith should not fail. And when you have returned to me, strengthen your brethren. At the Passover, there was strife amongst the disciples. They wanted to know who would be the greatest in the kingdom. And Jesus said to Peter, "When you are converted, strengthen the brethren." This was a key event, the Passover, in the leading up to the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. But this fact was lost on the disciples as they tried to figure out who was going to have the highest office in the cabinet. And today we are on the verge of the next big event, the second coming of Jesus Christ. And still there is strife amongst the brethren. You cannot fail to see that we are on the threshold of time and eternity. And we've been warned in scriptures that the troubles that we will face as believers, many of us, those troubles will come from where? Within. A man's enemies will be the members of his own household. Could be the physical household, could be the household of believers. Matthew 10, verse 36. Yeah, we can sing the same songs together. But see what happens when you pose a threat to people. Not because you are deliberately wanting to attack them, but just by doing good, Jesus says, you will attract opposition. Just by trying to live a righteous life, you will generate opposition. Jeremiah says that they will go to extraordinary lengths. In Jeremiah chapter 11, verse 19, they said, "Let us destroy the tree with its fruit, and let us cut him off from the land of the living, that his name may be remembered no more." These are the thoughts of unconverted people. And therefore, the admonition that Peter received is still relevant for us today. When you are converted, strengthen the brethren. And Jesus said to him, "The devil wants you." And what is the devil's task today? To stop you having a relationship with the Lord. Yeah, talk to me. What is the devil's, what's his task? He has a threefold purpose. Persecute, to kill, to steal, and destroy. That's his mission. To kill, to steal, and destroy. Whatever you have, your family, your joy, his purpose is to destroy you. He knows he has a short time. So what's he going to do? He's going to take as many with him as possible. But Jesus comforted Peter, and I take great comfort from that as well. He says, I have prayed for you. I have prayed for you. We were talking in our Sabbath school this morning about the need for the fervent and effectual prayers of the righteous. But Jesus is in our corner. And so he says to him, when you've returned, when you have been converted. In other words, when you've had a change of heart, when you have received the forgiveness of God yourself, then you can comfort and strengthen one another. I must first be reconciled. And you know, if you're struggling to forgive someone, I dare say it's because you are struggling to receive forgiveness yourself. Because if you've received it, and you acknowledge how merciful God has been to you, if someone comes against you, you'd want to forgive them just as much as God has forgiven you. And I think that it's incumbent upon us to look back on our lives and see just how good God has been to us. And then to say, you know what? I haven't got time to be holding on to grudges. And guess what? Unforgiveness actually causes sickness. Yes. It causes tension within you. David says, my bones were creaking when I didn't confess. And you having anger inside of you, it's just damaging yourself. So as the English say, you cut your nose off to spite your face. Yeah. But we need to encourage one another. We need to strengthen one another. Zechariah says we should each esteem each other better than ourselves. Can you do that? Esteem. Anybody in business here? Anybody in business? Got your own business? No? Okay, so you've got your own business. Somebody comes around and asks you to give them a price for doing a job. You put an estimate on that job. Esteem. You put a price on your fellow believer. You put a value to them and you esteem them higher than yourself. That's what we need to do. Don't think evil against your brother, your sister, but esteem them higher than you say, and than yourself. I've known from personal experience that sometimes people want to keep you where you are. Ever had that experience? You've been forgiven by God of things you've done in the past, but people want to bring it up, either in the church or at work or wherever. They want to bring up the past. But I read that when God closes a door, no one can open that door. And when he opens a door, no one can close that door. But sometimes fear of having the past been revealed causes us to make the wrong decision. So I want to say to you, if anyone tries to keep you in the prison of the past, just remind them that the Spirit of the Lord is upon Jesus, and he came to release us from prison. Don't let anyone imprison you again for what God has released you from. He says, I buried your sins, I buried your past in the deepest parts of the sea. Don't let anyone do that to you. God has forgiven you in your past, but men want to keep you there. And so I want to remind you of the story of David and Nathan. You remember when David had committed adultery with Bathsheba? And she got pregnant. Nathan came and he told him a story. And David was incensed. No, that can't happen. This is wrong. And Nathan just says, well, you're the man. You're the man. And David, when he was struck with that self-conviction and the child was born and died. And the Bible says that David says, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said to David, the Lord also has put away your sin. You shall not die. And I struck onto that phrase, the Lord also. Because it tells me that there's an agreement going on. Because I've confessed my sins, the Lord also has done his part. And he has forgiven me of my sins, 1 John 1 and verse 9. And so when God closes that door on your past, my friends, don't let anyone open it again for you. He says, I have blotted out like a thick cloud your transgressions, and like a cloud your sins returned to me, for I have redeemed you, Isaiah 44 and verse 22. David imposed a period of self-isolation on himself. Wouldn't eat for days. But the elders of his household went in to him. In 2 Samuel 12 and verse 17. So the elders of David's household arose and went to him to lift him from the ground. That's significant for me. The role of elders, of leaders, when people have fallen into sin, is not to point out their sins, but to go to visit them for the purpose of lifting them up. I'm also reminded of a scene in Revelation chapter 5 where the Lord is on the throne. In his hand is a scroll. And nobody in heaven nor on earth could open the scroll. Take a look at it. Revelation chapter 5. You see, because for me, I draw lessons from what I read here. Because right now, there might be someone here who has a problem that nobody could help you with. The bank can't help you. Church can't help you. Family can't help you. Revelation 5, from 1. And I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll written inside and on the back, sealed with 7 seals. Then I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the scroll and to loose its seal? Who is worthy to help me out of this predicament? And no one in heaven or on the earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look at it. That's how bad it is. So I wept much because no one was found worthy to open and to read the scroll or to look at it. And I dare say some of us have gone through situations like this where we're weeping. Maybe night and day, because we're in this predicament and there's nobody, it seems, able to help us. But then, here we go again. One of the elders said to me, do not weep. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the scroll and to loose its 7 seals. To me, I'm not even concerned about what's in those scrolls. For me, it's the fact that Jesus is able. He's able to help me, students. He's able to help me to study, to learn. He's able to bring to my memory those things that I have learned and you do feel at times, boy, there's absolutely nobody to help me. David says, who am I on earth beside you? And in heaven there is none but you. So friends, no matter what you're going through, no matter who helps you or doesn't help you, Jesus is able to help you. So when you are converted, strengthen the brethren. That's my purpose this morning. I just want to share some thoughts about how we can strengthen one another. And several times in Scripture you'll see it says, as you see the day approaching, or the day is at hand, and then it gives you certain instructions. I just picked out 7 just to share with you today. The first one is Hebrews 10:25. Now, I know because of restrictions lately, that's been a bit tricky. But that one says, don't stop meeting together. Because that strengthens the brethren. Yes, we can be connected electronically, and it's good to see that many churches saw increased attendance because of the online presence. But being here and touching each other, it's a different feeling altogether, isn't it? Touching is part of human nature. And so to be enforced for so long, a bit strange, but don't stop meeting together. One of the things that I stressed throughout the lockdown meetings that I did, because I said to the folks, look, being online and watching something isn't quite worship that is written about. So, you know what I would do? I would break away. I said, right, we're going to break for 15 minutes now. And I want you in your own homes to worship together. You know, what does that entail? Well, you say a prayer, you sing a hymn or two. You return your offerings. You share what God has done for you. Those simple acts of worship, so important. Because that's how this church started, in the homes. And then we'd come back for a sermon. But I want to encourage you as well, folks, in these days especially, reestablish that home worship. Don't need no restrictions there. You're there with your family, so even if you have to Zoom your family, some here and some somewhere else, bring the family together in some way, shape, or form, and have worship. Romans 13 and verse 11. Again, we're just saying what we can do to strengthen the brethren, especially as we see the day approaching. Romans 13 and verse 11. And do this, knowing the time that now it is what? High time to awake out of sleep, for now our salvation is nearer than we first believe. Now, he's not talking about your time to wake up, as in from a sleep, but in the sense of being numb to what's going on around you. Time to recognize, hey, the world is winding up. I need to be ready for when Jesus comes. And something I want to stress as well, and please listen to me carefully. Jesus could come at different times for us in this room. God forbid, any of us die tonight. Jesus has come. Because the next thing we know, we'll hear his voice. We could have been a day, 1,000 years. But the minute we fall asleep, Jesus has come. So I say to us, let's wake up, look around, and say, yes, the earth is groaning. The Lord is about to come. Yeah. How else can we strengthen the brethren? Well, Matthew chapter 4 and verse 17 gives us an instruction there. Matthew 4:17. After Jesus went out to the wilderness and the devil came to tempt him, from that time, after he had defeated the devil in the wilderness, from that time Jesus began to preach and say, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." We need to be preaching that message of repentance. And I even say the better way to do it is to live that life of repentance. Be seen as someone who's moved away from the way you used to be, because then that will attract people's attention. They see you, but they praise God. That's what we're looking for. Because you could say to people, repent and repent, but you're doing sins just as bad or worse behind the scenes. So live the life that they can see, and they will ask about the Lord. Mark chapter 1 and verse 15 tells us to encourage belief in the gospel, the word of God. Romans chapter 5 is another important thing that we need to do as we strengthen the brethren. And a lot of these things begin with yourself first of all. Romans 13 and verse 12 tells us that we need to cast off verse 12. We could also include that the night is far spent, the day is at hand. Therefore, let us cast off the work of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the day, not in revelry and drunkenness, not in lewdness and lust, not in strife and envy. Yeah. Philippians chapter 4 tells us to show our gentleness to everyone. Yeah, someone riles you up. You want to tell them a word. That count to 10 is so true. Put yourself in the place of the one who has been wronged. Look how many times you and I have wronged Jesus. We talked about in Sabbath school, the Bible said that he was sorry he made man. Yeah, he was sorry the things that we've done. That's why he regretted, not that he made us. Otherwise, he wouldn't come and die for us. So, whatever you want to mete out to somebody, just put yourself in their place. How would you like to be received? And finally, James 5 and verse 8. He says that we must strengthen our heart. You see, because the heart is easily discouraged. James 5:8. You also be patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Friends, I just want to leave those words with you. Look out for each other. Respond to calls for help. Offer help. Because that's how we're going to keep strong together. Who has been missing from your fellowship for weeks, for months? Has anyone been in touch? Just a phone call. We missed you. It's amazing what it does for someone when you call them or text them or whatever you do. When you wake up in the morning, if a name comes across your mind, call that person. send them a text message or whatever. I have always found it that people will come back, you know, I was so glad to hear from you. I was a bit down and what you sent me just lifted my spirits. That's how the Spirit of God works, you know. Mobiles wasn't just invented in the last 10, 20 years. The Spirit of God puts me a name in my head. I call and they know because you were there wanting some help. And I called. That's how God puts people together. So for Cheltenham, strengthen each other. The day is coming. And I'd like to be able to stand and recognize everyone here when I get there. I hope you'll pray for me as I pray for you. Because that's all that we have. Showing love is the key. You and I can preach till the Lord comes, but if we don't show love to one another, sadly, Jesus will say, I didn't know you. And that's another important lesson for us to learn. Connect to Jesus first. Develop your own relationship with him. And that will help you to reach others for the kingdom. I'm going to give you a few moments to talk back to me, to reflect on what you've heard. If you have said anything that doesn't make sense, let's clarify. If you have a query, let's spend some time together. That's how I am. So, does anyone want to say anything based on what you've heard right now? Does it make sense? Is anyone here struggling? We need to pray for you right now. This is worship, so talk to me, please. Yes, sir. First of all, go ahead, lady. Yeah.
That's the first sermon I've heard for a long time that has
really. Oh, praise the Lord. My brother. Yes. The practical demonstration of your faith is the key. The Bible says it. If you come to my door and say, look, have you got some food for me? I can say, no, sorry, but go and be well, be fed. And I have it and I can't help you. What's the point? Practicality. Yeah. We're very good at preaching, but can we show that to people that we meet on a day-to-day basis? In Matthew 25, 31 to 41, where Jesus comes and he divides the sheep from the goats, if you read that story, there's a phrase there that should stick out at you. Both the saved and the lost said to Jesus, when did we see you? Both the saved and the lost said, when did we see you? In other words, because they said, Jesus said, I was hungry and you fed me. I was thirsty, you gave me to drink, and so on and so forth. When did we see you, Jesus, and give you food and clothe you? He says, well, if you did it to John down the road, you've done it to me. And equally, the lost says, well, and Jesus says, well, if you didn't do it, you didn't do it to me. That tells me that whatever they did or didn't was a way of life. It was instinct. They didn't have to think, oh, should I help this man? Something inside of them, compassion, says, I can't go on until I've helped this person. Showing what we believe is the key. Anyone else? Let's talk for a while. bit chilly out there, so let's warm up in here. Anybody else? What's on your mind? Students, I'm going to pick on you now. Uni life. I've never experienced it, so, you know. Sorry? I can be thankful. Some of the challenges that you face as a believer in uni. How are you coping with that? The studying and the books and the reading and so on. How does that impact you and your faith? How does that... Talk to me about that. Are you top of your classes, those of you who are taking exams or what? Yes. Yes.
Come the Sunday, it's like, right, I've got to do double the work.
Right. So it's one of those. What I found in any other sphere of life, when you set your mind to please the Lord, he opens up opportunities for you. So yeah, you say, I'm going to come what may. It's tempting to spend the day doing some studies, but I'm going to go to church to praise the Lord. He sees that. And he allows other things to happen to you to make up the time or whatever it is. So yeah, ignore the pressure and say, Lord, that's important, but knowing you is more important. I want to spend the time with you. Anybody else? What's on your mind? Anything that we need to pray for right now before I go? Sorry? Yes.
For the family, because you know, different time of shift work and then to meet with the student, so it's really challenging.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, sometimes when you do have the worship, you want to know if you're going too long or, you know, if the kids will be too, because you have a young adult, you might have a teenager, which could be challenging because obviously.
Yeah.
Don't see each other some days till another day or so.
Yeah.
So to get that, you know, that spirituality or that worship time in, how could we improve like as parents? Because sometimes we do feel that you're neglecting that time and that's an important time for their life. For me, it was important growing up, you know, with my grandma with worship time. And because it was a different setting or so, you know at certain time you wake up for worship. But now, you know, in this time, you have to work around everybody to get that worship time.
Yes.
You don't want that when they walk off or they walk that, you know, there's something they must remember. And you cannot depend on the church because I always believe that, you know, Christ likeness comes from the home. And more so, I have a teenager, you know, that wants to give his life to Christ and I don't want him to go into it and then, you know, later on,
sure. Yes. Well, I grew up in the generation, my sister, where, you know, you're woken up at some, I wouldn't say, I used to say ungodly, but no hour is ungodly. But you know what I mean. You're not with it. You're not open. You're not alert. But, you know, you've been woken up. You've been shaken out of your slumber. It's not enjoyable. And yes, you can't both be there because of your working condition, but whoever is there with the two of them, have that time. You know, that's all you can do. And let them be a part of it. Let them contribute. Because if you're invested in something, you will be more interested. You'll do more rather than you just have to sit and take it. You know, so I would say give them an opportunity to share. And I always, Pastor asked me if I had children's story. And I don't do children's stories. If there were children here today, they would be up here. and they would tell me their stories. No matter what it is. Oh, grandma gave me more money this week. Whatever it is. That's their testimony. Because I want them to get into the habit of testifying and not just once a year or whatever, at the end of year service. They need to get into the habit of having that experience with Jesus for themselves. So I would say strengthen your family. And mom, even though you can't be at home or dad can't be at home, be praying. If the family is at a time for worship, you can't be at home that time, then wherever you are at that time, you're praying towards home and so on. But, you know, let it be an engaging opportunity for them as well. So pick your time carefully as to when you do it, all right? That they can be there and be present in mind as well. Anything else before? Yes, sir.
Problem is two things is for the Sabbath. That's happened. What happened? The manager asked me to work in from 5 days to 1 hour. When I just calculated my Christmas calendar, I see the Monday asked me to work in the days is Friday from Friday morning to seven to Friday seven at night. And I called him and said, no, it's not good for me. I can work on Friday night. When he was at 6 o'clock, his 6 o'clock is Sabbath. He said, from 6 o'clock, it's not for me. At 5 o'clock, I'm supposed to be home to prepare for 6, 7 o'clock. No. But he accepted to give me Friday off. But for the Saturday, say no.
So.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yesterday again, the job I find now, something I like in it and I really want to do, they ask me to do it and 2 days. I say no, for 2 days is no. I don't know, if you accept another day, okay, for 2 days, you say if no more day is set to do. Is that something how Christians more understand that other, we need to pray for each other. Because somebody misunderstands what is the Sabbath, how the Sabbath starts, how the Sabbath is done, how to connect with God in the Sabbath. Somebody, we all of us need to pray for each other.
Yes. And you know, no matter how good a job you've been offered, the first thing you need to get on the table is your Sabbath. The very first thing. See, because what you're doing, my brother, you are opening up a door for somebody who comes after you. If you say, no, I can't work on the Sabbath for whatever reason, and you have to forego that job, guess what? God is going to open up another one for you, better than the one you've left behind. But if you take it because, oh, this is nice. Money's nice. Conditions are nice. And then you want to get your Sabbath off. And there's a problem. It's going to be hard. Somebody else comes and, you know, wants to have the Sabbath off. They know that you and me are both Adventists. Well, Mike's all right. Why do you need to go? You know, so be careful. Don't live your life by other people, but stand up for what you know is right. And God will look after you because you're doing right by Him. He'll do right by you. Yes, sir.
Can I just add a point to that? It's something that's really, really worked in my experience, and that is that when I go to an interview, I sell myself, but I do the interview first. And I let them see that I'm worth the job on my abilities. And then, when they offer me the job, I say, okay, fine, I'm happy to accept the job, but this is what I want you to do for me.
Mm-hmm.
And so I let them think that I'm good enough for the job first,
mm-hmm.
and then I put the Sabbath on the table. But I will always put the Sabbath on the table before I actually
say yes. Yes, good point. We can't let this guy go. We got to have this guy. I like that. Yes. Yes. Yeah, and that's fair enough. There are many of our members, and Pastor will testify this, who work in the medical field. They are doing a work of mercy. And that's perfectly fine. It's good to do good on the Sabbath day. Mm. So yeah, there are exceptions, like you say. Yes, absolutely. It's not carte blanche, you know. There are certain roles that you can do because you are actually ministering. You're a minister. You're ministering to people's needs. Yeah. All right. Well, thank you very much. But let's look out for each other. Let's strengthen each other. Start with our families and strengthen the church as a whole. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for this time together. We thank you for this band of believers. You've heard their stories. And I'm praying, Father God, that you will visit each and every single one. My brother's got an uncertain employment future. I'm asking you to speak to whoever he goes next and prepare them for that question, and that they'll respond positively. Lord, I pray that as we see the day approaching, being with you, being with each other, will become increasingly important in our lives. Help us to demonstrate you and our faith to those that we meet. I pray a special prayer for our students, that you will empower them with your Holy Spirit. Let them stand out from the crowd. Let others inquire of them the way to go. Pray for the leadership of this church, Lord, that you'll bless them and give them direction to reach those in this community for the kingdom. Finally, Lord, I'm asking you to forgive us all of our sins and grant us your peace and your blessing. In Jesus' name we're praying. Amen and amen. Amen.
Mike, for that, it was great. We're going to finish with a final song, so I'd just like to invite the praise team to come back and lead us, and then Mike will finish with a blessing. Shall we stand?
My feet on higher ground, Lord.
let us arise and face this way. No storm may dwell with us abound. My prayer, my aim is higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. My faith on heaven's table land. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to Satan's stars that we are held. For faith has caught the joyful sound, the song of saints on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright, but still I pray till there I found, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land.
Lift up his face upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance on you and give you peace now and forevermore. Amen and amen. Amen.
Thank you, everybody, for coming. Thank you to those of you who are at home. We are back here at 5 o'clock for the bank.